Greetings, everyone. My name is Glen Howard. I'm president of the Jamestown Foundation, and we're starting a new series at Jamestown where we are focusing on regional experts who have been involved in field research and also keeping an eye on Eurasia. And so I'm delighted to present for the first part of the series a discussion with Jacek Bartosiak, who is president and CEO of Strategy&Future, a Polish organization that deals with grand strategy and developments in Eurasia. And Jacek is very well known, has just completed a trip to the Suwalki Corridor and has recently developed some observations from that trip. And we just wanted to have him in a brief spotlight to kind of share his thoughts on what's developing and emerging in Suwalki based upon his observations. Jacek has been involved in this region for quite a while and is viewed as one of a handful of Polish strategic experts that have constantly Americans and others go to when they need a quick fix on the, kind of their perspectives on the Polish views of the world and how Eurasia is changing. So I just like that. Jacek, you just came back from a week-long trip to Suwalki. So why don't you start us off by sharing some of your recent observations and insights on that trip, and we'll start the conversation going there.
Hi, Glenn. Thank you for having me. With you talking about the security situation. Actually, with my team, we decided to make a terrain tour. And we're doing a project for one of those famous organizations that deal with speed of reaction, speed of movement and maneuver into the Baltic Sea Theater. And we wanted to check with our own eyes what is the sort of connectivity there. I mean, how really to get there, bridges, crossroads. And we were trying to simulate the behavior of the Polish force that would be earmarked to help to consolidate the Baltic defense. So we were trying to behave as we were the troops, okay? The real troops, decision makers. So we moved northeast from Warsaw up to Estonia. Even we arrived in Narva on the Russian border, 145 kilometers to St. Petersburg. So, like designing how to project power and make it feasible.
So based on your trip, what did you see different this time? And what do you see the developing in your observations from previous travels through the Suwalki, through the Baltic in terms of security?
There are some developments in Poland on the Suwalki Corridor itself. The railway system is being upgraded. There were some American troops moving around checking the crossings. We established that with the locals. We investigated. We did the recon with our own eyes, but also with our ears. We talked to people in the region. What they see, how the troops maneuver, how they exercise, what they do, what people talk, what is happening to this bridge or another bridge. So there are some upgrades in Poland on the Suwalki Corridor. But already in Poland, I noticed a few things that really are very concerning. I'm not talking yet about the infrastructure, but the challenges to really carry through this operation. Some of them are well known. For example, that there are actually only two roads leading to Lithuania. The right one, I mean, the one on the right, number 16, is too close to Belarusia, and it's too narrow, and its flank is too forested. Actually, you never choose this road to Vilnius. So you choose the other one to Kaunas through Mariampol, but it's still too close to Belarusian Grodno, which is a great connectivity hub from which you can really easily project power and make your right flanking maneuver, the maneuver on your right flank, highly vulnerable to any action from Belarus. For Polish troops, that creates quite a challenge. And as a result, it will create the challenge for the cohesion of NATO, political cohesion, and the escalation theory, and also the goal of this war, of the campaign. Grodno, which is in Belarus, actually is hanging on our right shoulder. You can't do anything. If you really think militarily about it, So my first observation is that we need to address politically the question of Belarus. And not only because of the weight of Brest and Smolensk, which is directly upon Warsaw, but even if we only wanted to have a limited war with Russia, projecting power into the three Baltic states, it's still operationally debatable.
So you're saying that there's two routes. One is the N16, and the other is the road that goes to Kaunas, which I believe is also now the site of a railroad that has been developed between Poland and Lithuania. So what in particular, you're saying that the second route through Kaunas, that road needs to be further expanded and developed?
I think it's good enough. The problem is that the second, the bigger one, is, first of all, still too close to Kaliningrad Oblast, Kaliningrad Enclave, and within the direct and indirect fire from Kaliningrad. So the long-range fires can also cut the supply line of this slog. Then secondly, the terrain is flat, it's very tank terrain, very much of tank terrain, where you can really amass troops. And if Russians control the bridge crossing, okay. And the Nemunas River flows north between Kaunas, Jurborg, and Soviets. And there are only two bridges. I mean, in Kaunas there are many, but between Kaunas and Jurborg, there is only a bridge in Jurborg, and it's almost 100 kilometers. And that creates an obvious choice that you project power to Kaunas, which makes it easy a target if Russians seize the bridge in Jurborg. And they control their own territory in Kaliningrad. So they can easily attack the exposed left flank of moving, the logistical line to Kaunas. And especially if Russians move swiftly and their center of gravity is Riga, which they seize quickly, and then their secondary, and most importantly, but secondary in terms of time, is a land bridge to Kaliningrad, they will have a huge operational advantage because they will choose the place of the tank battle, the place and the time and so on. I think it has to be addressed also prior to any hostilities. And if we were living in a perfect world and if it were only upon the military to decide, the natural response would be to create the buffer zone into the Kaliningrad, at least like 50 kilometers, to the axis from Gushev to Soviets, and move the Russian forces away from this main artery, strategic line of communication, so that we don't have any surprises here. Also, we need to seize the Jurborg Bridge. And the Nemunas River actually doesn't allow, maybe there is only one place between Jurborg and Kaunas.
And for those of our viewers that don't, familiar, you're calling it by the Polish pronunciation, I believe in European geography it's called the Niemen's River. Is that the correct
Niemen River is a Polish name. Nemunas is Lithuanian, and I noticed in the English maps that it's Nemunas. So the current Lithuanian name, and it used to be a river within the old Polish Lithuanian Commonwealth. We called Niemen. And usually it divides the sub-theaters of war operations.
Jacek, thanks for offering that kind of descriptive view. I think a lot of the people that follow Suwalki, there are people that are diehard geography fans who understand the geography of the region. And then there are those that kind of know and have heard the name of the Suwalki Corridor and are kind of familiar with its importance to NATO and to the security of the Baltic states. And for those that don't follow this issue, the strategic discussion started off with a geographical determination that Suwalki was a choke point for NATO in its interactions with and ability to protect and secure the Baltic states. When Ben Hodges was commanding general of the U.S. Army in Europe, this term became very much kind of I think it was believed it was first described by the former president of Estonia, Tomas Ilves, who was trying to fixate American attention on security of the Baltic and the need to protect it, and equated it to the fold the gap, and then subsequently kind of started referring to it as Suwalki gap, which is a narrow sliver of territory between Lithuania and Poland, where Belarus borders that area. And so many people consider it a choke point, but the ability of the United States to kind of reinforce the Baltic in the event of an attack from Poland is something that a lot of strategic analysts spend a lot of time looking over the maps and trying to understand it. Now, the Suwalki Corridor began with a SEPA report where they identified it in our strategic lexicon as a need for to describe the region as a corridor, and one where we're reinforcing the Baltic states with NATO troops and U.S. forces from based in Poland, and therefore there's a need to preserve the corridor. So that is kind of the short description summary of the term and use of Suwalki Corridor. Jacek, let's continue your discussion. You've kind of described how vulnerable it is, the area, but I'd like to continue on your trip northward. You talked a little bit about the N-19 and the other road to Kaunas, but continue your discussion on your insights about your recent trip and how you know, what else did you discover on your trip?
You know, what is, there are two more overriding observations that I made. So maybe let me continue with those. First of all, is that, again, I witness on my own skin that the Baltic states are bigger than they appear on the map. Actually, much bigger. Even Poles, we are much bigger than our neighbors. So we think that, you know, that these are small countries. In fact, when you travel there, use the car, use their, you know, scarce roads, actually. They are not small countries. Moving there is not easy. It takes a lot of time. And eastern parts of all of them, and especially Estonia and Latvia, these are really deserted places. And there are no people. There are no people. And if there are any people, there are Russian speakers, which means that within the new generation warfare concept, non-linear and limited warfare that Russians apply, they will have a huge operational advantage by using the fog of war and disinformation. Because even if they move, we'll be pounded by thousands of pieces of information that nothing is happening, and there will be no people on ground to verify it. These are really empty places. And if they are not empty, I will repeat it, these are Russian speakers, like in Narva or many other places. That's the big observation. The second observation is that if Riga is the center of gravity, and I think that it is, and if I were Russians, I would only move quickly through southern Estonia, through this town of Voru, and connect to Latvia and get to Riga quickly, I would also make a diversion amphibious operation north of Riga, and there are beaches there and small ports that allow for that. Okay, especially if you project power from Huma and Sarema, and if you had seized Huma and Sarema with, you know, marines or amphibious Spetsnaz, then you can also make diversion. And because the force in Latvia and Adaji is so small, they will not be capable of reacting to all directions. And there are so many water reservoirs and channeled corridors of movement around Riga that the Russians could tie our laces on the shoes quickly if they use the speed and multi-axis of advance. And it has to be addressed, in my opinion, as well.
So what you're saying is basically a Operation Albion in reverse, what the Germans launched in World War I against in Moon Island and those areas. So this is, you're saying that there's almost a reverse scenario of what the Germans did in 1917 when they launched their invasion using maneuver forces. Is this something, you know, where the NATO manpower issue, I mean, for example, where would the Canadians be in all this? I assume their eyes are looking are looking east and not looking towards the Baltic. And many people kind of focus on the ability to hold territory in Latvia is based upon the Canadians holding the ground with the Russians in the east. But you're pointing out that the NATO's flanks in the Baltic are very vulnerable to Russian naval operations.
Yes, they are. There are many implications from what I just said. First of all, preemptively, the NATO forces need to have presence on Huma and Saaremaa prior to any hostilities. We cannot allow the Russians to seize those two islands that will completely create the anti-Axis denial bubble. And it's doable. It's, you know, like exercises, okay?
Are you saying that NATO should put permanent forces on those islands, or are you saying that because the Estonians have a self-defense force that they also have units on those on? I think Solomon is the largest of the islands. Are you saying that that's not enough forces?
I think it's not enough. I think there should be some rotational moving presence, exercise presence of NATO troops, including anti-ship missiles on the islands, like, for example, Polish NSMs. And we employed, actually, already those last year to show the Russians that we can locate the Gulf of Finland. And so we need to take a more proactive stance. So we need to change the posture to a more proactive. Second, I think that the posture is wrong, at least from the perspective of interests of Poland. The NATO troops are located close to the, you know, capital cities to screen those cities, to consolidate the political will to sustain, you know, to keep on going, while the geography and the terrain in the perfect world should push the NATO forces quite close to the Russian border. Because the terrain in the east, notwithstanding the fact that it's, you know, deserted and so on, the lines of sight are short. There are narrow roads through forests. So even with light infantry and with some active defense and the sort of reserve tank force, you can really, you know, engage them quickly and stand the ground, as opposed to, you know, when you let them in. And especially when you let them in, and that these are small countries, so they will be inclined politically to defend their own capitals. They will have a cascading effect, as when you defend only Riga, then the Russians may cut to the middle to Lithuania. And the same, by the way, with Estonia. So again, the geography shows that in reality, those countries are bigger than it seems to be on the map. And by itself, the current posture is not providing the proper deterrence by denial, not to mention by punishment, because actually on paper, Russia is winning it. This is the feeling.
We'll continue our listeners are very interested in kind of learning more about your trip. You know, you spent a week there. So continue kind of going north as you were traveling. What else did you see? What did you feel? What were your thoughts?
I checked all the surroundings of all, you know, NATO bases in three countries that screen the approaches to the capital cities. I checked all the roads leading there and the bridges, how they could, for example, envelope or surrendered or not allowed to break out. I checked all the bridges to the capitals. North of Kaunas, I was also checking the probability of, I mean, I was checking the tank warfare. So south of Kaunas, it's a perfect tank warfare. The Russians could have as many tanks as possible and concentrate them in one battle.
And I believe north of Vilnius, I mean, I've traveled that area to Latvia. That's also a very good tank country. It's very
a bit worse, but still a good tank country. And especially for the Russian-made tanks, which are 40 plus tons heavy.
And it's important to note that the joint forces with the Germans based in Lithuania, that the Lithuanian army does not have standing tank forces. In fact, they've always traditionally been hesitant and say it's too costly for them to be able to develop armored forces. But you're walking the terrain observations. Again, you keep reemphasizing the importance of tank warfare in an area where the Allies have very few tanks.
True. And if they do have, they are very heavy, like Abrams and even Leo parts are very heavy. And the line of sight is not long enough to really make it worth for Abrams to operate there, okay? Because it's rarely bigger than 1.5 kilometer or 2 kilometers, which sort of almost equalizes the, roughly speaking, okay, the fighting, the combat.
Right.
The chance.
But in defense of the Lithuanians, they argue that they have hundreds of javelins and that mobile forces by the Lithuanians to fight hit and run and stop a Russian tank advance with the javelins would stymie any type of Russian armored offensive into Lithuania. How do you respond to that?
They would do it if they really try to control the crossings of the Daugpilis River. Okay, so because they would have the Russians being channeled into the movement, and then they can use the PPK, the anti-armor PPG, just to really instill havoc. But if the Russians break out to maneuver warfare, so the tank is the best beast then, because it can maneuver and it can really shoot fast. So, south of the Nemunas River for sure, tank will always win, in my opinion. And if it's not south of Nemunas River, north of it, it's still a good tank terrain where the Russians may expand in contact, okay, to the flanks and outflank, and the javelins will not help them. So you need to employ javelins properly, okay? You need to have a proper training, and it's the best if they are used when there is a long line of sight, but the movement is channeled when you can expect them to go. And for example, if I were Russians, of course, I don't know what their general staff is planning, but if I were them, I would cut through Lithuania, not touching on Kaunas and Vilnius, not crossing the Neris River, where the Germans are stationing in Rukla.
And just briefly describe the Germans base, so the people listening may not know about the German units in Lithuania. Can you just briefly?
I mean, there is this NATO presence in three Baltic states, and there are Germans in Lithuania and some other components. There are Canadians and also Poles in Adaji in Latvia, and the British in Tapa in Estonia. They are close to, British are in a good place, so to speak, because it's between Rekvere, on the way from Narva to Tallinn near Rekvere, and also on the connectivity from Tartu. So it's a good place. I mean, pivot around just to see.
And these are the NATO enhanced forward battle groups, correct?
Yeah, we've got three
groups. You got the British in Estonia, you have the Canadians in Latvia, and then you have German units, about 1,500 men, I believe, with some air defense and armor elements in Lithuania. Is that correct?
Well, yes. And what I want to say, of course, I'm Polish, so I'm always biased, but we've had 23 wars with Russia, so we know this war theater very well. The Russians always try to hit the center of gravity. And what is the center of gravity in any war over the Baltic states? It's the cohesion of NATO. So they will try to achieve their operational objective, and this being control of Riga and creating the land bridge to Kaliningrad to get rid of their sole vulnerability. And by that, they would like to bypass the Germans for sure to create the lack of cohesion.
And the Germans are located where in Lithuania?
And in Rukla. Not in my personal opinion, in a bad place. In a,
okay, where's not, not, where's Rukla in Lithuania for our listeners?
It's between Kaunas and Vilnius, two largest cities. Behind the line of the Neris River, and not northerly enough to oppose the coming Russians if they wanted to cut through Lithuania and connect to Kaliningrad. They are in a good place if Russians wanted to seize Kaunas or Vilnius, but not in a good place if the Russians just wanted to create the land bridge to Kaliningrad and hold the terrain and announce, okay, NATO, and I'm try to come over and grab. We'll see what happens. So it might be so that Germans will not be fighting, because they will operationally, they will not be forced into the fight.
Is the location of the German units in Lithuania the choice of the Germans, or is it the choice of the Lithuanians?
I don't know.
That there's some debate over whether the German units are really forward enough in harm's way to stop some type of Russian armored assault, which is what you're alleging, is that you're basically kind of alluding the fact that they could be enveloped. Is that what you're saying?
Or even bypassed, and politically they could be told, come on, take it easy, guys.
Okay. So then we rely on the Polish armored units to come in and save, in theory, save the German units. And is that correct with US?
Yes. And now the fun begins. Because Poles will think twice. Because the geography of the Baltic states and the Suwalki Corridor, and most importantly, the existence of Belarus, that might be a platform for the Russian power projection, will make Poles think twice, at least, whether to move.
Right. So the...
In real war, I'm not talking about the political statements. I'm talking real stuff. Okay,
you realize by that argument that you're kind of undermining the report by SIPA that came out and said, you know, Suwalki corridor, NATO needs to protect it. And many people had questions, said, well, will the Poles put armored forces to protect that corridor, or will they stay home, as you're saying, stay home to protect the homeland rather than try to project power to an area where they don't even know where the Russians are going to be moving? Is that kind of your? I don't mean to pick an argument with SIPA, but I mean that's wondering. I know that there's this debate that exists within the community.
I don't want to undermine SIPA, especially that I cooperate with Ben Hodges, also during this terrain trip. But of course, we cannot hide problems under the carpet. And the problem is that Poland is the center of gravity of NATO Eastern Front. So Russians will be looking what Poland is going to do. And this is why, again, I think that the NATO posture in the Baltic states is flawed. Because if the NATO had a formidable presence in the Baltic states and in exposed positions next to the border, then we wouldn't have to think whether NATO will join us, because NATO would be there already inside the battle. And then Poland would easily secure the Suwalki corridor. It's a question of intention. You know, intentions change overnight. It's the capabilities that matter. And I'm afraid that Russians are looking at capabilities, not at intentions that can change overnight. And the problem is that without Poland, there is no independence of the Baltic states. And we know that.
Are you saying that is part of the Polish thinking, because the hesitance that you're describing, is that more traced to the fact that they don't have sufficient forces to do what the United States and what SIPA might be recommending, or where is that coming from in Poland?
It comes from the strategic consideration that if again you take a look at the map. So you see that in order to maintain the accessibility and movability through the Suwalki corridor, you need to project power in numbers to the northern eastern square of Poland, which is separated from the rest of Poland by the big rivers, the Vistula River and the Narew and Bug rivers. And because Russians were fighting this war many times with us. So it's in a repeated manner, the Russians stand to separate the Polish forces in the Polish war theater by outmaneuvering us and crossing and holding the river, the Vistula River crossings all along down to Warsaw and along the rivers. And they can do it from Kaliningrad, directly from Kaliningrad, and they can do it from Belarus. And if our troops are commuting.
So you think from Kaliningrad, there's a limited ability by Russia to project power, because some people would look at the configuration of Russian forces in Kaliningrad and say, well, they don't have enough forces to really project power. But what you're talking about or alluding to is kind of a limited ability to project power. In other words, to preserve Russia's own corridor to say to Belarus and Grodno. Is that kind of what you're?
And what I'm saying is that if, of course, at the moment, maybe they don't have capabilities to undertake a major enveloping operation along the Vistula River Valley and along the Bug-Narew Valley, but they used it and did it in the past, okay? And they exercise that in Zapa. So they can easily envelope our forces that are moving through the marshy and swampy narrow terrain to the Suwalki Corridor, south of those forces, and the game is over for NATO within a week without any fighting in the Baltic states. This is why the Polish government was also pushing the Washington DC to put troops east of the Vistula River. The problem is that the United States has never been in war east of the Oder River. On top of that, in the non-linear limited war. And the Russians have been here for 600 years.
Yeah, and we call that in Oklahoma, home field advantage.
Exactly. So we joke sometimes in Warsaw that when the decision makers in Washington and the strategies communities are talking about a peer or near peer competition in Eurasia, we are wondering who is near peer and who is a peer. You know what I mean?
Sure.
And this is so this is what it looks like when you're down in Eurasia. So and the Russians have been here. And the same goes to the Baltic, the Black Sea, by the way. But
it's interesting that you say that Poland has a view that they should be the center of gravity of defense of the Baltic. And you talk to the Lithuanians, and Lithuanians will tell you, well, they should be the center of gravity because they're highly and strategically important. And you talk to the Latvians, and they say they should be the center of gravity. And then you go to the Estonians, and the Estonians say, well, we need to create a Fort Trump in Estonia, and we're the center of gravity because we're defending Narva. So I don't want to pick on our Baltic allies here too much. And I think everybody has their own perspectives. What you're saying is that NATO's got a real, as we say, they're in a pickle over its defense of the Baltic and over these strategies, and you're there on the ground. So,
Glenn, if I may.
Go ahead.
But Spykman used to say that geography doesn't argue. It just exists. It just is. And the same with the center of gravity. Poland is the center of gravity because you need to have the communication line through Poland to the Baltic states to project power. The Baltic Sea will be out of the game, so you need to have Poland to project power. That's why you need to Suwalki Corridor. And it's been in the past like that. The independence of the Baltic states was quelled like a flame in the candle when Poland lost the independence wars. Mm-hmm. And the fate of the war was always decided on the plains of the Belarus and or Ukraine. This is between Poland and Russia, and between Germany and Russia and so on.
I totally agree. I mean, I think the debate on Belarus is completely lost on those people that are more interested in the democracy promotion and the status of human rights in Belarus, which is very important. I don't disagree with it, but the problem is that Belarus matters as kind of a geographical linchpin in Europe that we haven't completely understood, and we're even now still arguing about Belarus presidential elections. When democracy in Europe is really going to be based on whether there's Russian ground troops in Belarus or not, threatening the independence of of democratic states like Lithuania, Poland, and Latvia, which is why Latvia pushes the importance of Belarus. But I don't want to make this about Belarus. Your points are well taken. We don't have much time left. I'd like to just, can you continue your journey northward about what else did you find, you know, that stuck in your mind on your trip?
That, I mean, for example, that would be good if the defense planning of the Baltic states were coordinated between three Baltic states. I also wonder what sort of orders are given for the NATO troops, because I heard that they vary depending on the nation. So what are rules of engagement within one base, in Adaji or in other places? I think that the Russians will be exploring those vulnerabilities. Yeah? Also, I was in Eastern Latvia, and you know, I talked to a lot of Poles that live there, local people. And if the NATO posture in Latvia and Estonia and Lithuania was, you know, deterrence by posture, was supposed to deter Russians and reassure the locals, it didn't work, because the locals think that it's only, you know, the fad of Putin, whether Latvia is, you know, is still in Latvia or not, I mean, Eastern Latvia, because there are so many Russians there, the Russian speakers.
And again, the 50%, right? I think the total is Latvia's population.
I think it's less, but million. But in Eastern.
Yeah. And
the best schools are Russians there. And, you know, and so on and so forth. And it's very close to Russia proper. So lack of force there, NATO force, visible NATO force, is counting. And if you, especially if you take a long-term look, lang dure, you know, again, I mentioned that Poland's center of gravity. I don't want to be, you know, biased so much, but from my personal perspective, the posture is not adequate. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't take much to change it in terms of the, you know, spending and so on, but for some reason it's not happening and people are watching.
And what else did you notice from your trip in Eastern Latvia?
The roads are very bad, heavily forested, remoteness, immense remoteness between settlements. So the Russians may really create fait accompli without anybody is noticing.
But the Latvians point to how well trained and conditioned the Canadians are, and they view the Canadian forces in Latvia as a godsend. I mean, they are very highly professional. In fact, one person said they were more British than the British Army in terms of retaining many of the traditional methods of training of the former British Army, in the sense that the Canadians have retained a lot of that. But do you see the Canadians as being kind of pinned down in Eastern Latvia? I mean, are they, you're right, it's forested, there's limited maneuverability, and the Latvians are purchasing heavy artillery. I believe they're buying Austrian howitzers. So there's some ability, and they're getting former British APCs. They've been, which are very suitable for the Latvian terrain. So why shouldn't we be more positive and feel better about what's the defense of Eastern Latvia?
Glenn, what's the there is 50 minutes of flight for the land attack helicopters from Pskov to Riga. So what is there against them? Actually, not much, okay, in terms of the firepower. Of course, we can always say that the American fighters will come from Italy or from other places, but it takes time.
But NATO has its Baltic air policing mission. So,
of course, including the Poles. But, you know, but they're also in war. There will be Russian fighters as well.
But the Tornados are not exactly the best.
Glenn, the numbers tell. I mean, you know, I understand the contingency, Western Pacific, sequestration, you know, the debate, the turns by denial, the turns by punishment. I've been there, I've seen that, I understand all those dynamics, okay? But the problem is that when you make a field tour, the perspective changes, okay? That's what I wanted to convey.
Okay.
That's what, because it's a real thing, okay?
All
it's a real thing. Pskov is nearby. There are helicopters there and tanks and the Vodevo, and they can move, okay? And I'm looking what the cohesion of NATO, the different troops, different rules of engagement, where are the troops?
Okay.
And what do we achieve here by in strategic signaling? Are we really achieving what we want to achieve? And then I know because I also did simulations in the Black Sea region. I also know their situation there. And the pain is that Russia is weak. So it would be so easy to teach them the lesson. They don't have money. They don't have manpower. It's not Soviet Union. It's quite close to Petersburg. So they are vulnerable. They have vulnerability of Kaliningrad, but it's all about political statements and political strategic signaling, which is lacking as well. Yeah.
Well, that's a more of a political question for the NAC and NATO. I think that we would like to, you got about 10 minutes left, and I'd like to finish your discussion on your trip to Narva. And let's talk a little bit about Estonia, what you saw there.
Very long days. It's summertime, so almost no night. Very long days. Lonely places, and Narva when everybody speaks Russian on the street. Once you hold Narva, you can move along the highway to Tallinn through Tape and the Strekvere. That was a weird feeling. I was standing and I felt that I'm standing at the end of the Atlantic world, of the Atlantic construct that actually stretches from the first chain of islands in the Western Pacific through Hawaii and California and the United States, continental continents, and then Azores, and then Western Europe, okay? And it ends there in Narva, 145 kilometers from Petersburg. And that was a very weird feeling, because in Eurasia, everything is always on the move. So borders move, everything shifts, nothing stands still. And I was wondering, what will I say in 30 years time? Because it used to be Soviet Union. Actually, it was almost the suburbs of St. Petersburg. People probably traveled to Leningrad to work from Narva. Then they are in Estonia. And the openness of strategic flows, they could travel everywhere, work everywhere. Mm-hmm. They suddenly were in the European Union. It's always underpinned by the power of the United States. That's what it is.
That's true. But America cannot be in every location, every corner of the world, defending democracy. So. I'm not saying Estonia is not worth it. I'm saying we have limited resources. So,
This is why, Glenn, I was saying, if I may, because I would forget it. When we talked on my show regarding Turkey and Eastern Med, and the United States is sort of happy with that solution, that Turkey is like a proxy, balancing external powers and so on. So there are only two options for the U.S. to maintain the order, either to project power to Narva in numbers and in dollars, which is in doubt, or, for example, make Poland have a more robust profile and be a sort of really modernized force, project power further, and have this modern scouting battle further up to Narva, and create the new dynamics, okay? And actually in the history, we've done that many times. That would require the change in the mentality, but also in the mindset of Germans and other Western Europeans. But I think that slowly Poland is getting ready to that, for that. So that would require
But let me intervene. I think up until now, in post 2014, U.S. strategy in the Baltic has been, after the annexation invasion of Crimea and Donbass, that the U.S. strategy is more of to put small quantities of American forces as kind of tripwire, a holding pattern to hold the region, hold it until all those American reserve units in the U.S. and can get to the Baltic. And as you know, and I know, I mean, that's going to take time, and the time factor doesn't really favor the Baltic states. But let's be clear that U.S. defense strategy has been one of more of a holding pattern, trying to hold the region, putting, say, 150 men in each of the Baltic states. That was something that the Obama administration, I think Gerald Hodges initially did, and then he was overruled by Susan Rice, if I remember correctly, that they didn't want a permanent presence in the Baltic. So those units were kind of pulled out. But I think there still is some small American force there. But again, you know, 150 men is not, it's more symbolic to deter the Russians. And I don't think, I mean, deterrence is in the eyes of the, if you want respect from the Russians, you need armored divisions there in each of those countries, and that doesn't exist. So the other part is that, you know, that comes back to the question of some of the tripwire forces of the British units being able to hold their own against, along with the Estonians, to be able to hold off long enough until the cavalry arrives, so to speak. So, and you're saying long term is that the United States needs to kind of Poland needs to be kind of a version of Turkey in the sense of being a gendarme, an extension of American power for projecting power into the Baltic. Is that what you're saying?
This is in the model. This is the feasible solution to the scarcity of resources that the United States is facing, and contingency in the Western Pacific that is upon the U.S. and it shortly will increase, in my opinion. So that's the. What else can you do, Glenn? If you're telling that Susan Rice blocked the stationing of the troops east of the Nemunas River, which is a message in Central and Eastern Europe. It's a message to Russians, to us, to Ukrainians. Okay.
Well, I think the idea of the NATO Founding Act still kind of hangs in the shadows. You can argue about whether it still exists or not, or why, you know, if it doesn't exist because the Russians invaded Crimea and annexed it and Donbass, therefore many people argue NATO Founding Act we shouldn't abide by it anymore. So that kind of requires a debate on U.S. defense strategy and planning here, which they probably have already had. But going back to your trip, I guess we're going to have to wrap it up, but I do want to, what are your takeaways? I mean, if I were to say you, what are the three takeaways from your recent trip to the Baltic, what would they be?
The people are concerned.
The local people.
Local people are concerned. They don't want to have Russia over there. And they are concerned that might happen. I also think that politically, the Baltic campaign scenario is not properly addressed in terms of escalation control and cohesion of NATO. And the test for the cohesion will come from geography. As simple as that. Again, Spiteman, again, the old good geography. Because that splits the risks of the NATO allies. And it will be a huge challenge for Poland with our troops in Adaji. And it will be in Warsaw that decisions will be made what to do. and because we will be called upon to project power through Suwalki Corridor.
You know, there's some things you said, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but there's some things you said that are very interesting takeaways that apply to the Black Sea region, also apply to the Baltic. And that is, you mentioned Solomy Island and then putting anti-shipping missiles on that island as a way, what you're saying is to disrupt Russian operational planning and strategy. Sure. And I think that the U.S. should consider ways to help these countries disrupt the Russian operational strategy, because right now it's a very straight seam for the Russians, because there's no, we need speed bumps on the road to stop them. And I think the debate on enhanced forward battle groups is really not, we think that debate is over because we put enhanced forward battle groups, end of debate, right? I mean, so this seems to be kind of the conundrum the United States faces.
You know, war is always about the control of escalation ladder and the steps on the escalation ladder. It's enough if we make sure that we control a few steps of the escalation ladder against Russians, they will not go to war, okay? It's easy. This is why, for example, putting the NSM batteries on Huma and Sarema for exercises from time to time is create a huge, and sometimes prohibitive risk of cost for Russians to project power by sea and seize them. What if we, for example, move troops sometimes from time to time close to the vulnerable places in Russia, or if we put Kaliningrad enclave at risk, that they will lose this piece of territory?
And are you saying we need a Baltic island hopping campaign like we had in the Pacific, where we're kind of hopping around the Baltic, say Gotland, working with Swedes? I mean, kind of.
Of course, and preemptively, for example, making Swedes allow Polish Air Force to use their airstrips and thin out the perimeter, for example. Of course, I know the legal situation. I know what Sweden
yeah.
means.
Yeah, well, that's on. Signaling.
But
you know,
I'm talking about military geography and you know how you plan it. Finland, or showing mining capabilities. You know, the Germans in both world wars mined the entrance to the Gulf of Finland, and that cut the Russians out.
Yeah, bottled them up.
Okay, yes, yeah. Exactly. As easy as it gets. And there are also land corridors that can be mined. There could be sensors there. Okay, there are a lot of automated systems now that can be employed. Okay, it's a doable thing. And thinking proactively. So Poles could project power. For example, we should spy on all Russian maneuvering on sea. And for example, put troops on Bornholm in cooperation with Denmark prior to any movement so that the Russians see that our special operational forces are there always. For example, Gotland the same. And Huma and Sarema, Gulf of Riga as well. Many, many places, and also on land, the same thing. They could see us
well,
moving.
Let me tell you, I once had a conversation with General Mattis about Bornholm before he became Secretary of Defense. And I was talking about put a long-term presence on Bornholm, and he was strongly against that because Bornholm with a permanent presence would be highly vulnerable to Russian attack. In other words, ballistic missile attack. I mean, they would be exposed, and that's a fair argument. I think that's for the sake of argument, that's fair. But what you're saying is Bornholm, basically operational maneuver positioning, but not long-term positioning. In other words, we call that the whack-a-mole strategy, where the Russians are trying to figure out where we're going to, what we're
exactly.
doing. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. And had some, some ammunition there or whatever, but moving, even special operation forces or airborne, something for 2 days and back so that they know that terrain. So that we are not predictable. The Russians cannot predict what we're doing. Okay, we impose, we have the initiative. And I think it's a deterrent effect. And the same the Black Sea. We impose, they react. We
yes.
act, they react. Okay, and they spend money on reaction, and they're undermanned, underfinanced, and their geography is just killing them, okay? And they have to act along the, take a look at the map, along the external lines of communication, which is killing them. And especially if we include Ukraine in our planning, the game is over. They will be bankrupt within 5 years. And
that's a great, great point. And I'll let you finish. I didn't let you finish your last 2 points on your takeaways from your trip. You promised me 2 more. So I'll let you end with that, and then we'll conclude our discussion today. Do you have any other 2 thoughts? I've interacted there.
My palpable feeling that I was, I was feeling it physically when I was leaving the Baltic states is that Poland quickly needs to have its own operational concept for the new modern warfare, not only on Polish territory, but we need to look behind the Polish border, and we need to have the modern operational concept right away. And, we need to do it simply, okay? Because the time is making us do so.
One more thought. You have another takeaway from your trip, other than new operational concept?
And that we, in Poland, we need to address both politically and also in cooperation with our allies, but also militarily, how to split resources between the Suwalki Corridor direction and the NATO war, sort of, and Belarusia. This is the main way you were conducting war in Central and Eastern Europe. And we need to balance this somehow and create 2 forces, so to speak. And politically, we need to address it with the American allies somehow. What to do with Belarus? Also, if we project power through Suwalki Corridor, that's why I mentioned Grodno, the city of Grodno, as a pivot. Actually, you can't leave it behind. I mean, if it's only about military, Grodno connectivity is heavily imposing on your left flank of maneuver to Kaunas. Risky business.
Well, it's a very highly conflict-prone region, and I think that we need to kind of conclude our talk today. You've been very generous with your time. And I'd like to say your thought about the need for NATO to stop reacting, and we need to kind of impose. The Russians are the ones that are opposing, and we're reacting. And I think that's a fair takeaway from this whole conversation, is that our imagination needs to be a little bit more wider about how we prepare this region. And I want to thank you for joining us today. It's great to see you again. And thank you for sharing your thoughts. And we'll be posting this as part of a series Jamestown will be doing, kind of spotlight focus on Eurasia, and I want to thank you. So thank you, Jacek, and
thank you
to have you again.
Thank you very much for having me. Thanks.